All right, if you have your Bibles, we're going to be looking at Genesis 4 tonight. We continue our walk kind of through Genesis. And the story of Cain and Abel, that's what we're going to look at tonight. And even this morning, Olivia looks at me and goes, "Hey, I know that story." I'm like, "Yeah, I've heard it several times too." And most of you probably have as well. But one of the joys in working on sermons is that it forces you to kind of dive in and really see what the meat there is. What's something new that you can bring out? And sometimes it's not something new you need to bring out, but it's just a reminder or refreshing on what you can learn from this story. But I found this quote. He said, "At the moment I sin, I desire the sin more than I desire to please God." You know, as we consider Cain in our story tonight, and we consider what happened in Genesis 3, we are dealing a lot with sin. And this battle that wages and wars against us as we deal with it in our life. And we're torn because, you know, we want to please God, but at the same time, we've got this sin over here that we're battling, and we're fighting this war. And even Paul talks about this war that he doesn't do what he wants to do, and he does do what he doesn't want to do. And we all battle this. And I think tonight, as we dive into Genesis 4, there's some hope here that we can cling on to. There is some, even through the poor example of Cain, we can learn some things about God, and we can learn some things about fighting this sin battle that we all face. And first tonight, we have in Genesis 4 a potential hope. Look at verses 1 and 2. "Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, 'I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord.' And again she bore his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a worker of the ground. Though labor and childbearing are now painful, they will preserve the human race until the time when that special child, Jesus, comes of the woman and gains victory and saves his people. And Adam and Eve received this promise in faith. Adam named his wife Eve, which means the mother of all living, expressing his confidence that God would keep making alive until the deliverer should come. And Eve named her first son Cain, honoring the childbirth as a gift of God. Adam and Eve longed for that day that Satan would be crushed. They longed for the day when Christ would come and he would be victorious and sin would be no more. And the fact that they were able to have children provided hope for this reality." And I don't think we often think about it like that, but for Adam and Eve, you know, they may have known some of the consequences of sin, a lot of the big ones right away. But, you know, they probably didn't know the far-reaching consequences that sin would have one day. But knowing that through childbirth, one day there would come another who would save us from that sin would have been a great hope, a great promise that they would have clung to in their lives. And though Cain was the firstborn, Abel followed. Now, we can't be sure, but a lot of people suspect that maybe they were twins. It doesn't really matter, but, you know, some suspect this to be the case. But Cain, we learn a lot about him in this passage, and we learn about his family lineage. Now, Abel, we don't know a lot about because, frankly, he dies rather quickly in the Bible, and he also isn't the main focus of this chapter. So we don't really know as much about Abel, but there are two verses that stand out. Matthew 23:35 says, "So that on you may come all the righteous blood shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah." And then Hebrews 11:4, "By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous, God commending him by accepting his gifts. And through his faith, though he died, he still speaks." Abel, we see, was a righteous person, one who demonstrated faith. And though the fall had happened with Adam and Eve, even here, and we'll look at this more towards the end in verse 26, but even here we see that there was an acknowledgement, there was a teaching, a passing down of a desire and a need to worship Jesus. We see that already here in chapter 4. And we'll deal with that more here soon. But everything seems great going to this point. But what happens, right? A hope is squelched. Or a squelched hope is how I wrote it. Look at verses 3 through 24. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground. And Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but for Cain and his offering he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his face fell. The Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why has your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is contrary to you, but you must rule over it." Cain spoke to Abel his brother, and when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is Abel, your brother?" He said, "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" And the Lord said, "What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth." Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you have driven me today away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." Then the Lord said to him, "Not so. If anyone kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold." And the Lord put a mark on Cain, lest any who found him should attack him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. I'm going to stop there for now. But the offering we find here provides a window into the heart of the brothers. You know, as you think about 1 Samuel 16:7, the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." God looks at the hearts of men, which is something we cannot do. And even in this situation, as we look at the heart of the brothers, we see some things coming forth, don't we? We see these men's hearts being revealed to us throughout these chapters. Now, most of the time, we can only see the outward demonstrations of faith, and those can be revealing. But God looks at the intentions of the heart. Now, God, as the author and owner of life, God was entitled to the first share produced by the plants and by the animals and man, and to the best of what a worshiper had to offer. Abel brought both the first and the best, and Cain brought neither. Now, as we think about this, Cain brought an offering of the ground. Was there anything wrong with that? No, not in itself. There's nothing wrong with that. And in fact, think about this. Actually, Cain was actually obeying God's commands in one sense, because he was a worker of the ground. He was obeying God's commands to work the ground, to have the produce from it. That wasn't the issue. You know, we can see here, Adam did a good job teaching his sons to work. And though Abel was a shepherd of the flock, he taught his sons to work hard. But Abel brought the best sacrifice, not because it was of the flock, but as we think about the heart, what were the intentions of the heart behind this? What were the intentions of Abel's offering and Cain's offering? Abel's offering was acceptable, not because it was an animal, nor just because it was the very best he had, nor from a zealous heart for God, but because it was in every way obediently given according to what God must have revealed to them. Cain, disdaining the divine instruction, brought what he wanted to bring, some of his crop. He just brought whatever. Now the Lord had favor or regard towards Abel's offering and not Cain's. And as we think about Cain's response, we see that the failed offering provides an open window into the heart of Cain. The sin that Adam and Eve brought in the world passed on to their son, Cain. And we are given a look here inside what is going on inside the head of Cain. And often, you know, we can see the outward, what's going on with people, but it's often the inward stuff that we don't understand or we can't know. But here we're given a glimpse of what is going on in the head of Cain. And it would appear that Cain, as you look at that phrase, his face fell, or his face falling. That is another way of saying, and as you think about it, God not accepting your offering, is there really anything worse than that for Cain? And as you think about that, and Brother James and I were talking this week, it would appear that there's a sense of Cain falling into some sort of depression here. His face fell. What do we do when we become depressed? Our face falls, right? Shrink down. We're sometimes hurt. Sometimes we feel hopeless, like we didn't meet that standard. But instead of repenting and dealing with what had happened in a godly way, Cain allowed his unpleasant emotions, feelings, probably anger, sadness, as an excuse to avoid his responsibilities. Now, what Cain was experiencing was not unique to him. We all have these times that we experience some sort of depression, whatever it may be. You know, some of our greatest preachers of all time experience this for whatever reason. There's Christian men and women who go through these seasons that just can't explain depression. You think about Charles Spurgeon, one of the greatest preachers of all time, some say. But he had this time when he almost left the ministry because the depression was so great. And you think about his contributions to the church, how many people were saved under his ministry. What would have been lost if he had just walked away from the faith at those times? Think about what those things might be for you when you think about depression. You know, maybe for some of you, you've lost a loved one. Maybe something traumatic has happened to you, or maybe you're just going through a spiritually dry time. There are times when we go through that we seem like things are not going as well as we would like. But let's look and consider at a few things about depression. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but a few minutes I think are worthwhile. According to many biblical counselors, depression would be defined as a debilitating mood, feeling, or attitude of hopelessness, which becomes a person's reason for not handling the most important issues of life. Now, most often, depression becomes something where our feelings or our emotions are elevated to the point that they affect our actions. Think about Cain. Because his face fell, he was allowing that anger, potentially that sadness, to control his actions. And as we see in our passage, those actions led to him killing his brother, led to him killing Abel. Now, what should Cain have done? What would repentance have looked like for Cain? And as you think about Philippians 4:8, you know, Cain should have controlled his thinking. He should have changed his thinking. He should have focused on the answers God was providing, which we'll see more in a minute. But he should have come up with a better offering for the next time. There was an alternative to him allowing that to control the way he was acting and thinking. And this applies to us as well. When that spiral of negative thinking, when that spiral of sometimes hopelessness hits us, we spiral down. You know, out of the depths of that spiraling darkness, we see our Savior Jesus coming forth, don't we? He is our only hope in the midst of all this. Because we have a Savior who can sympathize with our weaknesses. We have a Savior who gives us the opportunity to repent and change. We have a Savior who is ever present in the midst of the valley that we go through. Now, I'm not going to stand here and tell you that it's always easy, because it's not. And I get it. It's hard, and sometimes it can feel like there is nothing else that can even affect our thinking. we go through these times, these valleys, and maybe you've not gone personally through a time of that, but there are people who have, and we need to be presenting them, showing them in the gospel, Jesus is the hope they need. Jesus is the only hope that can bring them out of that valley. You can live for God even when you don't feel like it. You can live for God even when you don't feel like it. And for Cain, he could live for God even though God did not accept his offering. Now, as we consider this passage, look at verse 7. Look back there. God says, if you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is contrary to you, but you must rule over it. Sin is presented here, this phrase, this term, as a wild beast seeking to devour Cain. Now there is a war taking place in Cain's heart, and we are given a glimpse of this war that is taking place. He has an opportunity to repent and change. He has an opportunity to bring a better sacrifice. Cain gives in to his selfish desires, as we'll see in verse 8, and he kills Abel. In the first murder in Scripture, Cain rejected the wisdom spoken to him by God himself. He rejected doing good. He refused to repent, and that crouching sin punched and turned him into a killer. Sin had mastered Cain, and the motives of his heart were evil. Now let's take a minute and think about motives. And this, I thought about this a lot this week. You know, why that little thing that happened to Cain, even if he was spiraling down, his face fell, what would lead him to murder his brother? And it's not like we have a lot of brothers on the earth or sisters on the earth at this time. No, we don't. But Cain rose up and killed his brother. What's the motives there? Matthew 15:19, I think, gives us a little help here. It says, for out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander. Out of the heart came that desire from sin to kill Abel. Cain had a choice. He had a choice, and I like to picture it. I call it a Y chart, and I look at Grant there. He knows what this is. He could draw it up here for me, but I like to think of it, you know, over here I can choose to please God, and over here I can choose to please self. So God, self. Now, every choice we make, we are either choosing to please God or we're choosing to please self, right? So I know my natural tendency is going to please self because Matthew 15:19, out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, and I am sinful. So I know my natural base answer is going to be here to please self. So first, I don't trust my natural inclination on a decision. What I do is read the scriptures. I just say do. Not say that. Christina would have talked to me about that one after. But she writes them down for me. But what I should do is read the scriptures. What does it say about a certain situation that I'm going through? What's it say? And even here, we find with Cain, God is telling him, sin is crouching at the door. You don't have to do this. Bring me another offering next time. You can repent and change and do better. He has given him sound counsel from God himself, and we have this same counsel in the Word right here. We have that same sound counsel from God himself telling us, what we should do and what we shouldn't do. And we have the choice to please God or please self, and often we just please self, just like Cain did here. He pleased himself. But we know 2 Corinthians 5:9 says, so whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. So as Christians, as believers, we are going to make it our aim to please God in all situations. Easier said than done. I get that. But that is the life of the Christian. Cain had the choice to please God or please self. Yet he chose to please self. Now, this murder had severe consequences. Severe consequences. Even more than we see than Genesis 3. we find very realistic consequences in these verses. Let me say, sin has consequences further than just what's happening at the surface. And we see, if we look down further in chapter 4 at Cain's family lineage, we see that those consequences just didn't end with Cain. No, they led down generation after generation after generation. And we see one of his great-great-great-great-grandsons further on, even commit murder even more so for a guy hitting him. So those consequences go further than what we can even imagine at times. And for us, I think about, you know, when I sin, it's not just affecting me, but I've got two little faces there who are watching that sin, and they see how I respond to it. Am I going to respond in repentance and change, or am I going to keep giving in to those sinful actions? Because they are watching exactly how I handle this situation all the time, whether we know it or not. Now, back to Cain. Now, as we read, looking back at the text, we see several things happen as a result of Cain's sin. He lies to God. Keeps getting worse, doesn't it? His work in the ground will now be cursed. He won't get the good stuff anymore. He'll be a fugitive. But we see God is still gracious to him, even in spite of his sinfulness. And that mark that he puts on Cain, most believe that it was probably some sort of tattoo or something that would have signified to those people that, hey, this guy's off limits. And we see Lamech in verse 23. He's the one that kills the man just for wounding him. Yet instead of having remorse, Lamech takes pride in his kill. This is that downward spiral into sin and evil. Once we take that step into sin, once we give way to sin, we will dive in. We will dive in, and it will hit us faster than what we can even imagine. It is faster, and it's sad to watch it happen. But sin has consequences, and some of them can even have further and further and deeper consequences. Don't give in to the lure of sin. Like I said 2 weeks ago, be killing sin. Fight it with every ounce of your being. Fight that sin that so easily entangles you. Push back at it. Put on the armor of God. Use the sword of the Spirit and fight back. Fight back. 1 John chapter 3, verses 10 and 12. You can write that down. It says, "By this, it is evident that those who are the children of God and those who are children of the devil, whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not live for his brother. For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We should not be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous." Cain gave in to that sin. Cain gave in to that evil one, devil. The children of God are evidenced by their love for one another. Having a love for one another is evidenced by righteous deeds, serving one another. A love for God is evidenced by denying self and pursuing Christ. So I bring this self side down, and I look to please God more as we consider that why chart I was talking about. Now, all is not lost with Cain. Though it looks hopeless here, all is not lost with Cain in our text, because there is a renewed hope. Now, look down at verses 25 and 26. "And Adam knew his wife again, and she bore a son, and called his name Seth. For she said, God has appointed for me another offspring instead of Abel, for Cain killed him." Even there, you can start to see that there was a hope based on this childbirth that there would be a future for mankind, that sin would one day be crushed. "But to Seth also a son was born, and he called his name Enosh. And that time, people began to call upon the name of the Lord, that time, people began to call upon the name of the Lord. Now, even though hope seemed to be lost in Cain and Abel, hope is renewed in the life of Seth. Now, Seth, that name is derived from the Hebrew verb translated appointed, the appointed one, which expresses Eve's faith that God would continue the covenant family in spite of death. Hope is renewed by the birth of Seth, and we see this through his lineage, and if we trace that out, we would see that more. But hope is possible for mankind. Hope is placed in the knowledge that one day Jesus will come and crush the devil, and this is what Adam and Eve look forward to as well. Now, notice verse 26. At that time, people began to call upon the name of the Lord. And this is one of those things where you start studying, and this never popped out at me before. This end of verse 26. And the more I read it, the more I started looking at other commentaries and things of what guys were saying. And, you know, I never caught the significance here. But in Adam and Eve's exile, they take with them faith in God's promise of salvation. They instruct their sons in the need for sacrifice. Now, though Cain failed, Abel got it, but then he's killed. But with their third son, Seth, there seems to be, in this passage, a worshiping community. Now, details aren't given, but the implication may be that this calling on the Lord's name began in Adam's own family circle. So we find here that Adam and Eve must have taken with them out of the garden a knowledge for the need to worship God, and they would seemingly be passing that down to their sons. Cain and Abel would have grown up with this knowledge, which shows us that we can do it doesn't show us that we can do everything that it shows us that we can train all our kids to do everything right. That does not necessarily mean that they are going to choose to believe Jesus and trust him. It doesn't hurt, but it doesn't guarantee that they will. That's why salvation is an individual decision. Now, that doesn't mean we shouldn't raise them and influence our children in the ways of the Bible and Jesus, but we must be faithful in doing these things. But I don't think this passage is a command for family worship. But I think it is acceptable to see the value of it from this passage. The need to pass down the faith is of utmost importance, and I think we can start to see that here. So what are some practical ways of doing this? Obviously, taking our kids to church on Sundays and Wednesdays is an easy answer, and it shouldn't be overlooked. You know, the early church dealt with these same things, but they were in hiding for many times, and though they didn't have smartphones where they could just pull out their Bible apps and all that stuff, or notebooks so they could even write them down easily, they developed things called creeds. And one of those, we kind of sung it a little bit this morning. Part of it's in that song we sang, but the Apostles' Creed is one of the more famous ones. It reads like this: I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, this was a simple way the early church taught their followers to remember the basic key tenets of the faith. And for us, are we teaching our kids the basic tenets of the faith? I found this in a class I was taking, St. Jerome, not a recent person here, but he says, instead of asking parents to give their children a fancy education in secular literature, nothing wrong with that, Paul asks the Ephesian laypersons, many of whom were engaged in the ordinary occupations of this life, that they should educate their children in every doctrine and counsel of the Lord. Overseers and pastors ought to take note of this. Now, that's not downplaying secular education. What it is saying is that spiritual education, teaching our children about the things of the Lord, should even be higher. That's number one. Teaching them about the ways and things of the Lord. Teaching them to deny self and please Christ, who we were talking about before. These are the key, some of the key tenets of the faith. And we must be passing this on. So here's some practical suggestions. Some of these we do, some of these we don't do, but some key things for a family worship time. Now, these are things that, let me put a caveat here. Some of you are parents, some of you are grandparents. So I understand that. Let me say, as a parent who has, for the most part, good grandparents, my kids have good grandparents. I think they'd like for me to say that, but they do. But it does nothing more joyous to me than hearing that, hey, we sat around the table. When Christine and I are gone, hey, we sat around the table with my parents, and we sang Bible songs, or we read the scripture together, or we prayed together last night before we went to bed. There does nothing to me that is more joyous than hearing those, because that shows me that they care more about my kids' souls than they care just about giving them every sweet thing that they want to give them, which they do get that too. But even more so, they care about their souls. They want to raise them in the ways of the faith. They want to teach them the scriptural doctrines of the faith because they care about their souls as well. Now, am I saying that we shouldn't just have fun sometimes? No, we should have fun sometimes. We should do these things together. And for us, you know, worship time for family time for us usually consists of Titus jumping on my back, me trying to read, Olivia trying to tell Titus to get off my back so she can understand what I'm saying. You know, it's not always perfect. I don't want this to sound like it's going to be some fabulous kids are sitting right here and that's it. No, that's not what it's like. But, you know, we read 5 minutes, if that, passage of Scripture. We talk about a few key points of it. Livy's to the age now where she can answer some questions that I give her. And even now she's taking notes on what I'm saying. And that joys me. Like, we can talk about that later. You know, and Christina will sing a song. We'll do things together. We pray together. And we move on. Now, does it happen every night? Not always. But several nights a week, we do it. Now, is this the only way? No. But it shows our kids that our faith doesn't end on Sundays and Wednesdays. Our faith is a daily endeavor to pursue Christ. Our faith is a daily endeavor to be in the Word, go to God in prayer, and live this Christian life as God would have us. And as we've seen tonight, deny self, pursue Christ with our lives. When a family engages the Word of God together, shares prayer requests together, or enjoys worship music together, there is a deeper connection as hearts are opened in real life, real concerns, real fears, real hopes, and real needs all begin to trump the ever-busy calendar. Chores, meals, dishes, TV shows, video games, appointments, meetings, dance rehearsals, baseball practices, and the church events, and the things go on and on of the given week, leave us little, meaningful, private, undistracted family time. But when we pencil it in, when we make a priority to spend 5-10 minutes together as a family, worshiping Him, we put a priority on the sense that God is important, our faith is important, and we want you guys to pursue Him with life. So through Seth, we find a renewed hope in Genesis 4 that one day the devil will be crushed. Jesus is coming back. And we know it gets worse before it gets better. We'll see the flood here in a few weeks. But after reflecting on Genesis 4, after thinking about it with some fresh eyes, I encourage you guys to commit to living a life that pleases Jesus. Take sin seriously. Don't allow self to always be trump. Don't allow it to always be king of your life. It is not king if you're a Christian. Jesus is king. What He says goes. We obediently pursue Him and obey Him. Choose to trust that God is faithful. Choose to thank Him for the grace He gives us every day to accomplish this task. Father, I thank You tonight for bringing us together. God, I pray for encouragement for parents, myself, for grandparents, those who don't have children yet. But I pray that, God, You will push us to sharing our faith, passing down legacy of what we hold true, the Word of God, to our children, to our grandchildren, to our great-grandchildren. And they will see the desire to live for You, do You, their lives. God, be with us this week. I pray that we will be faithful in our walks with You. In Your name we pray.